Hello, Malty. Maximum multi-mouthed, mild-mannered maltsters. Hey. Thank you to Mike Addison Snape, for that malt mention. Ralphie here, self-isolating, in the Bothy, and about to review this. Glenfiddich, 18-year-old, single malt. Bottled in the UK, the British Isles, at 40%. You probably get it at 43% if you're in the US, you lucky people, because you're definitely getting a superior version of this. And I'll come to that shortly and I'll tell you why, because you're probably getting it bottled at 43% alcohol. In the meantime, let me introduce this. A widely available, compactly packaged, accessibly priced, well, in the UK anyway, I can only comment on where I am. simple cardboard box, tin lid, nothing too ostentatious. You don't feel that you're paying a premium for the packaging, put it that way. But Glenfiddich, as we know, is a light style of Speyside whisky. And we've got to bear this in mind when approaching older aged versions of Glenfiddich. It's a very visible brand, widely available, which is one reason I'm reviewing it. I haven't reviewed the 18-year-old before, but I've reviewed other versions of Glenfiddich. And I would say that it's rather like Glenmorangie. It's consistent, dependable, you know what to expect. And this particular brand tends to deliver that. It delivers that experience. Interestingly, Glenfiddich Distillery actually uses direct-fired stills, which is a bit surprising. Well, some of the stills are direct-fired, which is surprising to people because there is a tendency that a direct-fired still creates a more substantial, toasted style of whisky, as exemplified by Glenfarclas, for example, or in fact Springbank. But with Glenfiddich, it still retains a light character. Very accessible, no problem giving it to someone who's not used to heavily flavoured Scotch whiskies, because this is the opposite of that. It is, I would say, definitely delicate, light fresh fruits, not peated. And I do notice that it's very easy once you've tried the 12-year-old version of Glenfiddich that you can move on to the older aged versions of this particular single malt, and you're not going to be in for any unexpected surprises. You're not going to get a sudden change of flavour profile or intensity. Now on the nose, excuse me, I'd just like to reassure you malt mates that that cough is a wet cough, not a dry cough. So I'm fine. I've just had some buttered toast. That's the reason why I'm having that kind of cough. It's a one-off. The nose has light pear notes, soft vanillas, almost a slight cream soda note, and floral, light bananas, little touch of pineapple in there, a little touch of melon as well, a little touch of apple. Nothing's heavily stated, it's all quite condensed. And I'm also noticing that there's this soft oak presence. It's almost a creamy oak presence. Nothing harsh, nothing sort of resinous or sappy about it. So even in nosing it, you're immediately aware that there's some what you would call sympathetic cask maturation, combination of sherry and bourbon casks in here. And even before I taste it, I have a growing confidence that these are good quality casks. First taste. Slow arrival. Sweet, sour, good combination. Fresh, fruity, quite vibrant. But I've only just poured it. What I can tell you is once it settles down, the complexity starts to build as you move from that fresh fruit signature of Glenfiddich malt to more cask engagement, involvement in the taste, just as you've noticed in the smell. And it's very nicely done. As regards adding any water to this, proceed with caution. I highly recommend that. I would be quite comfortable about just drinking this neat, because this particular bottle is at minimum legal strength, which is a shame for an older single malt. I'd say that's the one reservation I have about this, apart from the fact that, yeah, sure, it's been chill filtered and there could well have been colourant added. It probably is. But when you're adding water, and I'll get this done and dusted so I'm not just waving a spoon around at the camera like this. Add no more than a few drops. Seriously. It is very easy to drown this whiskey because it's light, delicate and older. So that you, if you add too much water here, you're going to over dilute it and it's simply going to lose its dynamics and its intensity. And as it does so, the flavour will start to fall apart. So I've literally added a few drops of water, we're giving it a couple of minutes. Already there's a little bit more resinous notes coming through, a little bit more overt cask influence. I'm noticing some raisin notes coming from the sherry casks and some vanilla notes coming from the bourbon casks. It's a very accessible whiskey in this respect. So given that, well, I've given it 1 minute with some water added. So coming back to the nose, slightly creamier. The freshness, that sparkling freshness is kind of diminished, but as it diminishes, there's a certain butterscotch note appears, which is very pleasant, and it's part of the animation of the malt, having given it a few minutes in the glass and then added just that little drop of water. Taste wise, much softer on the palate. But that softness is making the balance between the spirit and the casks more visible in a very pleasant way. It's, you could call it a dessert malt. It's not a malt that you would combine with heavy flavoured foods if you were doing any pairings. You leave that to the Laphroaigs and the Glenfarclases and the Springbanks. But with this as a pleasant summer's day sipper, you can't go wrong. A great starting malt, by the way. And the main feature of this, when I say starting malt, I'll just finish that by saying, if you're having a wee flight of single malts, particularly if you're doing older ones, this would be a good one to start with, just to get your bearings on your palate for that cask influence being more assertive than it is in younger malts. It works well that way. And I've given it another minute now in the glass to open up. As I've said, it doesn't matter which malt it is, a minute in the glass for each year in the cask. And this shows this principle up really well, because that delicacy of flavour has required delicacy of maturation, and Glenfiddich have done that really well with this particular version. There's a slight creamy smokiness coming off the malt now, so we're getting a bit more complexity than when we first started, and it was quite, for lightly flight flavours, lightly delivered. There's quite a lot going on. You've got to really slow things down to get the fine nuances and get the subtleties here. And it is a subtle whisky. Now there's a butterscotch note becoming more intense, more richer in flavour. Creamy, vanilla, a little bit of cinnamon, a dusting of allspice in there. So that even in the few minutes that I've been discussing this, you've probably noticed that the range of flavours as they appear and subdue as the whisky develops is quite busy. But you've got to take your time, because it's easy to miss if you rush it. One more taste before I give my malt mark. There's a more of a fullness on the arrival, a little bit of bitterness. So this is kind of creeping into the event. Bitterness from the oak wood, probably primarily from the sherry oak wood. The quality of the casks is self-evident. They're delivering their influence lightly on the malt spirit itself, which is really quite good. So that for a beginner, it's a safe one to go with as an older aged single malt at an accessible price, depending where you are, of course. But importantly, for the experienced single malt drinker, someone that's really got their bearings around the delicacies of flavours, is a really interesting example of how dynamics work in single malts. So that if you've got, say, Lafroy, particularly younger Lafroy's, the event is intense, it's swift, it is very assertive. And this, in fact, is really the opposite of that. So we're getting beyond the flavour the flavour itself, and even the sensations of the involvement of sweet, sour, salt, savoury and bitter. And you're getting this emphasis on the character here. And the character is light from start to finish, a light malt. And it's something that we don't pick up on initially in the early years of our journey with single malt. But if you're looking for a definitive expression of a light complexity, this'll do it just nicely. The one drawback, as I mentioned earlier, is that there's a trade-off here. It's available, accessible. It's competitively priced, certainly in British Isles, compared to other 18-year-old single malts. But it is bottled at 40%, the minimum strength. And if it is bottled at 43%, what I've discussed with you, what I've been talking about in presenting this malt review, you're going to find it a little bit more dynamic, for the simple reason the additional alcoholic strength is simply carrying more flavour, because it's alcohol that carries the flavour, not the water content. And there you go, now you know, just sharing. One final sip before I whip out my malt mark. Clean, fresh. It's what you'd call well composed. There's nice balances going on. You could see that they could have swamped the Glenfiddich signature by using heavier oak or more assertive oak influences. And it would be a very easy option, particularly with juiced sherry casks with sherry residue in them. And you could get this sherry blanket, sherry overcoat that you find in some other malts, which either works or doesn't work. Here, you can see the confidence and experience of production showing very successfully. I shall now give this a mark. Naturally, it's not an outstanding malt. It's too weak, alcohol percentage-wise, for that. I'd love to try this at 46% unchill filtered, so we've got a more positive mouthfeel. But here we go, 85 out of 100. This, my maltsters, is a malt mark. It's not a basic malt. It's not any kind of malt, because I've been thinking about this, more about this shortly. Trying to divide single malts into basic malts and integrity malts is confusing people. I'm aware of it. I've experimented with the format now for a while. It's actually creating its own problems in an attempt to create a solution. Therefore, what I'm going to do is I'm going to stick to the one malt mark now, but I will highlight when a whiskey is an integrity bottling, which this isn't, absolutely not. And what I'll do is simply remove marks if it is if it's been chill filtered and colour added, and that's the reason for this mark. It's a lovely malt, but I've got to bring it down a wee bit because of the style of presentation. Simple as that. I hope you've enjoyed this Ralfy review. I'm self-isolating, as I mentioned earlier, here in the Bothy, which is easy for me to do because I'm out in a remote place with a low population. We've had plenty of warning as regards the current pandemic. I'm not going to discuss that in any way. I think that you have got more than enough opinion, perspective, information and propaganda to go on where you are. I may discuss it later as objectively as I can, without making any overt judgments on it. But what I would conclude by saying that it really is an opportunity to take stock of what we're doing with our lives, where we're going, how self-sufficient that we are within the environment we find ourselves. And we've really got to keep ourselves as well informed as we can and be objective as we can under the circumstance. Many negatives have a positive, and there's plenty of negatives out there. Good luck to you. I would say, as I mentioned in my Fitter Philosophy channel, one of the best things that we can do is re-examine our own personal health and the way we prepare and look after our own personal immunity to the bugs, bacteria and viruses in the world around us. And one of the easiest things to do is, sure, in moderation, consume our alcohol in moderation, but actually boost our immune system in the simple ways: exercise, clean eating, healthy food, locally sourced, support local businesses, and boost up vitamin D, particularly vitamin D3, and with vitamin C. Boost ourselves. Garlic, by the way, I don't know if you're a fan of garlic, I am. I have it. Here's a Ralfy recipe. I'm going to conclude now on a Ralfy recipe of a slice of wholemeal, homemade bread using organic or low GMO ingredients. It's good to make your own bread. It's very therapeutic. Toast it and then use some fresh crushed garlic mixed with a little paprika and turmeric and black pepper, and you put it on the toast, the hot toasted bread, and put some butter on top. Yeah, good old fashioned butter. Spread it about and eat that, because garlic is one of the most effective natural antiviral foodstuffs that we have access to. And in fact, during the medieval times when plagues were going around, the plague doctors, you know, these spooky guys with the big beak masks that you see featured in Venetian costume festivals, mask festivals, with the big beak, these beaks that they had were there for a purpose, and they were stuffed with a combination of fresh crushed garlic, rosemary, lavender, and other tonic herbs, which were very effective in suppressing the toxic effects of viruses and bacteria in the atmosphere. I'll leave it at that. I'm Ralfy, safe and secure in the Bothy. We've got a bit of a lockdown going, and I'm telling you, with the stock that I've got, I'm not too worried about it. And also, more good news, the pirates are now busy joining the Buccaneers. They're not attacking the Bothy here, the Irish Sea Pirates. They're not creeping up the river to try and steal my whiskey. They're too busy now sourcing and delivering toilet paper and pasta, dried pasta, to retailers, because that's what they do. I'm Ralfy. Where's my clicker? Thanks for joining me. As far as I'm concerned, for the foreseeable future, it's business as usual in the Bothy. Stay safe, malt mates.